Hello and welcome to St. Peter's Lutheran Church here in Lexington, South Carolina, on this seventh Sunday of the church season of Easter. Of course, this is also Memorial Day weekend, and so normally it's our practice here to ask the veterans to stand and be recognized, as well as including opportunities for prayers for those who have given their lives for the sake of our country. As far as us being together in this place, we won't be able to do that, but of course we can keep all of those folks in our prayers as part of our worship today and throughout the week. Just a couple of things to share with you quickly. One is just the very exciting news that we are going to come together at least for an outdoor worship service starting next Sunday. So for Pentecost Sunday, May 31st, we'll gather at the lower end of the cemetery out back, 10 o'clock worship service, and you'll be directed as how to get back there for that service when you arrive. It is a service where we want to stay in our vehicles, so we're going to stay in our cars for the safety of everyone and for the social distancing, but we're certainly looking forward to at least be worshiping together in person. In our prayers this morning, in addition to Memorial Day, we do want to remember the family and loved ones of Daniel Smith, who did pass away, and he received Christian burial. The graveside service for Daniel was this past Tuesday. And also the mother of our member, Susan Bailey, passed away last week, is Barbara Summers. So we want to keep Susan and all of her family and loved ones in our prayers as well. I believe that's everything we wanted to share with you by way of prayer concerns and announcements. So our worship service does begin now with the opening hymn.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe.
For in your wisdom you have formed us.
You feed the hungry and clothe the naked.
We bless you and praise your name forever.
You set free those who are bound.
We bless you and praise your name forever.
You raise up those whose courage falters.
We bless you and praise your name.
You provide for our every need.
Accept our grateful praises.
You have called us from all peoples.
We rejoice and bless your name forever.
You bless your people with peace.
We bless you and praise your loving grace.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe.
For in your wisdom you have formed us.
God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O King of glory and Lord of countless angels, in triumph you ascended to the highest heaven. Abandon us not to be orphans, but keep your Father's promise to send your Spirit of truth. You live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Our first reading is Acts chapter 1, verses 12 to 26. Then the disciples returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary the mother of Jesus and his brothers. In those days Peter stood up among the brothers, the company of persons was in all about 120, and said, "Brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us, and was allotted his share in this ministry. Now this man acquired a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. And it became known to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the field was called, in their own language, Acheldama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his camp become desolate, and let there be no one to dwell in it, and let another take his office.' So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection." And they put forward two, Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also called Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, "You, Lord, who know the hearts of all, show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We read together in unison Psalm 68, verses 1 through 10. Let God arise, and let his enemies be scattered. Let those who hate him flee before him. Let them vanish like smoke when the wind drives it away, as the wax melts at the fire. So let the wicked perish at the presence of God, but let the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. Let them also be merry and joyful. Sing to God, sing praises to his name. Exalt him who rides upon the heavens. Yahweh is his name. Rejoice before him. Father of orphans, defender of widows, God in his holy habitation. God gives the solitary a home and brings forth prisoners into freedom. But the rebels shall live in dry places. O God, when you went forth before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth shook, and the skies poured down rain at the presence of God, the God of Sinai, at the presence of God, the God of Israel. You sent a gracious rain, O God, upon your inheritance. You refreshed the land when it was weary. Your people found their home in it. And your goodness, O God, you have made provision for the poor. Our second reading comes from 1 Peter, chapters 4 and 5. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is time for judgment to begin at the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 17th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all flesh, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of the world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you, for I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know in truth that I came from you, and that have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I am praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. And I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Hey, everybody. Good morning. Hope you're having a good one. You're probably thinking I look a little different. Yes, I did get a haircut. It's short now. I like it. Hope you like it, too. But like I said, I hope you're having a good morning, and again, I miss you. We want to see you in person. We're excited to, and hopefully it'll be really soon. But for now, we have this awesome video that we can do for the children's message and for our whole service. So let's dig in. For the children's message today, we're talking about Psalm 68. Psalm 68. In Psalm 68, verse 4, God tells us, Sing to God, sing in praise of his name, rejoice before him, his name is the Lord. So God tells us in this psalm to sing to him and to rejoice in front of him, rejoice because of him. So why should we sing to God? Why should we rejoice? Why should we be joyful in front of God? Well, let's think about it. I think the answer would be that God gives us every good thing and that God is the best thing that there is. So let's keep thinking about it. I brought some of my favorite things along with me. So I've got a video game controller right here. I love video games. They're super fun. I used to play more, but I still play every once in a while. I have a PlayStation. Maybe you have an Xbox, a Nintendo Switch, something like that. That's super fun. I have a Frisbee right here. I love playing Frisbee. I love playing disc golf, if you've ever heard of that. It's one of my favorite things to do. I have some coffee. Now, you guys might not like coffee. Maybe you've seen your parents drink this, or other people at church, or even your teachers at school sometimes. I love coffee. It tastes so good to me. If you've had it before, you might not like it, but I love it. And then last but not least, you've actually already seen my Bible. I love reading my Bible. A lot of us do, because it teaches us about God. It's a very valuable thing. And guys, God has given me every single one of these things. All of them. He's given them all to me as gifts, as things that I can play with, drink, read, and enjoy, because God loves to give us good things because God is good. So maybe you take a second, think of some of your favorite things that you enjoy playing or doing. Maybe it's a video game or a game you play with your family. Now think about this. God gave you your family. God gave you the house that you live in and the food and water that you eat and drink every single day. God has given you every good thing because God himself is very good. And the most important thing that God has given all of us is his son, Jesus. He sent Jesus to die on the cross for all the bad things that we've ever done so that we could be forgiven. And we know that we and God are good and that God loves us. He loves us. So guys, anytime this week, maybe you see a Bible around, or maybe you even see your parents drinking some coffee, or you see your favorite video game, whatever it could be, maybe take some time when you see that thing, that really good thing, and maybe pray to God and thank him for what he's given you. So let's pray together. Put your hands together and bow your heads with me. God, thank you for giving us every good thing that we have, especially for giving us Jesus. Thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross and forgive us of the bad things that we've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our sermon today comes from the second lesson that we have shared as part of our worship. I lift up especially for you chapter 4, verse 13 of 1 Peter, where we read, "But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed." This is our text. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, most holy Trinity, we pray that you would speak your word into our lives now in such a fashion that when we experience times of suffering because of our Christian faith, we might keep the faith at those times. And we ask it in Jesus' name and for the sake of his gospel. Amen. And so this morning we want to take a few minutes to look at this section of 1 Peter, a fantastic book of the New Testament, this marvelous letter from Peter to the churches in a rather large area known as Asia Minor. Today it's really the better part of the country of Turkey. And in this letter, Peter is addressing Christians individually, but also clearly Christian congregations all throughout that region. And at this particular point in history, the Christians are suffering persecution. They are being persecuted because of their faith in Jesus Christ, because they call themselves Christian. In fact, we believe that Peter composed this letter while he was imprisoned in Rome in the mid-60s, during the persecution of Emperor Nero. You may recall that story of how this despot Nero started a fire in the city of Rome and then blamed the Christians for it, and that was the genesis of a persecution to get rid of these Christians from the Roman Empire. And so it was during this period that Peter is writing to these churches who are suffering, encouraging them to keep the faith. Peter challenges the churches to remain faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ. How? To remain faithful by leading holy lives, even and especially considering the circumstances in which they were living, namely suffering and persecution. And so when we read this letter, it's helpful and important to recall that's the situation that Christians are dealing with and that Peter's addressing through this letter. It was not uncommon during this period of time for Christians to be arrested, hauled off to jail, tortured, and even killed. Now, we think about that in terms of today, and you might be saying, well, that sounds interesting from history, but what in the world does that have to do with us here in the year 2020? At least in the United States of America, we don't see our friends or neighbors being hauled off to prison, being tortured and even killed because of their Christian faith. Although we do remind ourselves here on a pretty regular basis of the fact that there are Christians being persecuted throughout the world today, even at a higher rate than they were back in Peter's day. Marvelous ministries like Voice of the Martyrs keep us informed of these goings on, and we strive to keep the persecuted Christians in our prayers. But again, just because the police aren't hauling Christians off to prison or worse, just because they are Christians in our country and our community, doesn't mean that there is no persecution going on, that there aren't more subtle forms of suffering with which Christians are confronted. Back in 1981, I was working as a traveling salesman and had just been promoted to a divisional sales supervisor. And my company was allowing me to also go to night school to work on my MBA. Well, it just so happened that a friend of mine that I had come to know while I was in undergraduate school at Mississippi State, he had been in graduate school there. He got his doctorate degree and ended up getting a job teaching at a university in Florida near where I lived. And so I was able to enroll there and even had him for some classes in the MBA program. And so we would get together after the class, and I even spent time with his family before I would commute back home to where I was living at the time. And I'll never forget, after I had been going to school for over a year, halfway finished with an MBA, we had left a class that he was teaching that night and were heading back to the house when I told him that I had made this major decision to quit my job, to turn down the promotion I was being offered, and I was going to go off to seminary to become a pastor. He absolutely lost his mind. He started yelling at me and cussing me and telling me what a waste it was and how he didn't believe in God and religion, that was for weak people, and just ranting and raving with his teenage son in the back seat of the car riding with us. It was awkward. It was an awful experience for me. And we didn't speak anymore for quite some time. Eventually, we were reconciled to a certain degree, but he never, ever changed his mind about what a waste I had just thrown my life away. Living with that was something of a challenge. I remember going well, 20 years ago almost now, but going to my 30th high school reunion. I literally had not been back to my high school in Southeast Florida for 30 years, had not seen any of the people there. And when we got there, there was one of the guys who I had grown up with there and had known all of my early life there. And when he found out what I was doing, that I was a Lutheran pastor, he made a point of cussing and taking the Lord's name in vain. Every time I found myself in a little group having conversation that he was a part of that group, he made sure he interjected taking the Lord's name in vain and cussing and bad-mouthing Christianity, just trying to get a rise out of me, I guess. But it's not fun to have to deal with that kind of thing. How do you react to that? What should we as Christians say when we find ourselves being attacked like that, suffering that kind of conversation? I mean, how about you in your workplace? Have you ever seen situations where maybe you or a coworker had your Bible on your desk and somebody came by and saw it there and wanted to report you to the boss, or they saw a Christian screensaver message that you had and they saw that and attacked you and said, you're not allowed to do that here, and reported you to the bosses, right? Or maybe you're in the coffee break room and people know that you're a Christian, and certain folks, if they see that you're there, will make a point of getting where they know you can hear them, and they'll start telling off-color jokes or using racial slurs or whatever just because they know you're a Christian and they want to try to get a rise out of you or see how you're going to react, try to test you to see if you're really going to practice what you preach as far as patience and kindness and loving and so forth. You see, there are more subtle ways in a culture like ours where Christianity can come under attack. And in fact, as we've been seeing here in the recent years, it's even less and less subtle as far as the divide in our country between, for example, pro-life and pro-choice, or some of the gender identity issues in our culture now. Christian faith, Christian ethics, Christian witness is being challenged. How are we to deal with that? And you know, Peter even tells us in today's reading that not only do we have to deal with this kind of persecution, this kind of suffering in the culture, but the devil is out there too. That the devil is out there like a roaring lion, prowling, seeking someone to devour. Maybe even similar to how God allowed the Satan to throw all those terrible things into the life of Job. Maybe, mysterious as it is to us, that the Lord does allow the devil to throw certain things at us that tests our faith and tempts us. Maybe throws certain diseases at us, throws certain problems into our marriages or into our jobs, tempting, taunting, whispering in our ear. We have to be ready for him all the time. How are we to react to all of these things? Well, that's the marvelous inspiration of 1 Peter. Peter addresses that for us. And notice, again, as he writes in chapter 4, verse 13, when you find yourself suffering, and please notice, this is very important. It's not just suffering in general. It's not just hurting in general, having problems in general. It is suffering because of faith in Jesus Christ. It's suffering, even being persecuted in some way, because you are a Christian. In fact, it's fascinating to note, it says there in chapter 4, verse 16, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, and so forth. Suffers as a Christian. That's only the third time of three times total that the word Christian is used in the New Testament. The word Christian is used twice in the book of Acts, and this one time in 1 Peter in the context of being persecuted, of suffering for the faith. So in verse 13, Peter begins giving us some real specific advice. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's suffering, that you may also rejoice and be glad when His, Jesus, glory is revealed. And he continues on, and we get down to chapter 5, verse 6. And what does he say? Peter, writing to these Christians, says, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on Him, because He cares for you. What do you do when you find yourself suffering because of your Christian faith? Cast your burdens, cast your anxieties on Christ, because He cares for you. He loves you, and He will help you through that time. Be sober-minded, Peter says. Be watchful. Your adversary, there it is, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him. How? Resist him firm in the faith, Cling to faith in Jesus Christ, crucified and risen, with which you have already been graced. Cling to that faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brothers and sisters in Christ all around the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen, Peter says. And so, in really all of 1 Peter, and most especially in chapters 4 and chapters 5, Peter is answering this question for us. The question could be put this way: how are we Christians, you and I, how are we Christians to respond in our culture, in the places where we live and work? How are we to respond when we are suffering because of our faith? When, in fact, our society, our culture, even our neighbors are making life miserable for us just because we carry the name Christian? How are we to respond? He says, live in the world the way Christ lived. Jesus is our teacher. Jesus is our model. And more than that, Jesus is our help. Jesus took upon himself the true sufferings and persecution of the whole world and the power of the devil, and he overcame them all by dying on a cross and rising again, so that all who believe in him have his power to endure and to overcome. Jesus gives us his gift of faith and the power of the Holy Spirit to endure the suffering and respond to the suffering as he responded, by loving and caring, by having patience and kindness and gentleness, self-control, peace. Jesus, crucified and risen, gives us the very help that we need. And so when the suffering comes your way and comes my way, we need to cling to faith in Christ, turn to him again, and receive his help, receive his rescue, receive his very power. Peter wants us to know that good does overcome evil, because God in Jesus Christ has already overcome the power of sin and the power of evil and the power of death. But Peter also wants us to know that while it is true that God overcomes evil, that overcoming does not come without a struggle. A very real part of being a Christian is to recognize that there will be this daily struggle with evil, with the devil, with the power of sin in this world. Our calling is to keep the faith in the midst of that struggle, and to even bear witness to the love and the hope and the promises of God in Jesus Christ, to love the very people who are persecuting us. It's a marvelous letter. It's a marvelous word from God to give us not only the hope that we need, but the power that we need to endure the sufferings, knowing that ultimately God wins, knowing that we're not in this struggle alone. We have millions of brothers and sisters in Christ throughout the world and throughout history in the struggle with us. And we can pray for each other and support each other until that grand and glorious day when Christ returns to fulfill his kingdom. And so may the Holy Spirit add blessings to these words for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, your disciples trusted in you when they had to replace Judas among the 12. Help us to hear your voice and to trust your word in our lives whenever we have important decisions to make and when we are uncertain of what to do. We especially ask for your help for our church as we work together to make important decisions on how to proceed with our upcoming events and gatherings. We also want to lift up anyone who is faced with decisions to make related to their family life and their work as we continue to navigate our day-to-day life in this pandemic. Help us, Lord, to seek and follow your will, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Holy One, around the world, there are faithful followers of Christ who are being persecuted daily for their faith. We know you are with them, encouraging them, loving them, and guiding them. May we do the same, and may their courage and hope inspire us to greater service in your name. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Healing Lord, grant your mercy and healing spirit upon all those who are battling illness, disease, loneliness, or heartbreak. Give them your comfort and fill them with all hope that Jesus has won the day, that he has overcome the world and so overcomes death and the devil. We pray especially this day for the family and loved ones of Daniel Smith and the family and loved ones of Barbara Summers. We pray for Pat, Bunny, Judy, Brent, Carolyn, Pastor Brett, Don, Sam, Pastor Bill and Cheryl, Sarah, and Carolyn. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty God, in the wake of difficult times around the globe, we pray for our leaders, both near and far. May they lead with wisdom and judge with equity. Grant them all they need to care for the people you have entrusted to them. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for all of those serving in our military today and for those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice for our freedoms. We pray for families who are grieving the loss of loved ones who died in battle. We pray for prisoners of war, for those who are back home and still recovering emotionally and spiritually from all that they had taken part in. Lord, we ask that you would help us to be grateful for all that you have given us in our country. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face shine on us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we look forward to seeing you, many of you, in person next week. God bless.